is Dr. M. Aruvanan. He completed BHMS at Sairam Homeopathic Medical College, MD at BD Jetty Homeopathic Medical College, Dharwad. He worked in the Department of Radiology, Institute of Child Health and Hospital for Children, given VRS, and pursued homeopathic course. At present, he holds the post of Senior Vice President of IHMA, Technical Director at Sharp Lab Services, Medical Director at Great Care Health Center, Guest Lecturer at Venkateshwara Homeopathic Medical College, Chennai. I welcome you, sir. I also welcome our Principal, Dr. Praveen Raj, Vice Principal, Dr. Roshan Pinto, AO, Dr. Pragnya Alva. Now, I hand over to Dr. M. Arun for the session on radiology in clinical practice. Over to you.
So good evening, everyone. Welcome to this session. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Welcome you all to this interesting session. First, let me thank my beloved Dr. Praveen Raj, Principal of Alva's Homeopathic Medical College, and the Student Council for giving me this opportunity to be with you. You all know nowadays investigative procedures have become mandatory. When the patient is entering into our clinic, simply they are coming with a bunch of reports and files loaded with images. Before opening their mouth, they are putting everything on the table and asking us to look at that. We as homeopath, we know there is no disease. Only this, or let it be the latest virus, COVID. Whatever may be the disease, we are having our own medicines, which is proved very long back and shows efficacy for the past more than 200 years. Now, investigative procedures have mandatory for certain purposes, mainly to see the prognosis of the patient and to rule out certain diseases, how it is evolving. Now, let me start my first slide. Yeah, here is a X-ray of chest PA view. Now, why I am showing this X-ray is mainly to tell you an interesting story behind this X-ray. One of my close friend, he has received a patient few months back with a chest pain. So he asked the patient to go for ECG.
No, sir.
ECG was taken.
Sorry for interrupting, sir. Sir, PPT is not visible, sir. It's not open.
Yeah, it is not open.
Yes.
Yeah, 1 second.
Yes, sir. Screen open.
Now, is it okay?
Sir, not visible, sir. You just once stop sharing and again you can start resharing, sir.
Is it okay now, Manish?
Yes,
Manish,
sir.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir, not clear, sir.
No, yes. You are telling about the image?
Yes, sir, image is visible, sir.
Okay. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir, now visible, sir, we can see.
Oh, it's good. So this patient was entered into my friend's clinic having chest complaint, chest pain, and asked, the doctor asked for the ECG. ECG shows some variation. Meantime, he has come with the X-ray chest also. His X-ray chest shows gross cardiomegaly. And he diagnosed that the patient is having with all the other vital signs. He asked the patient to go for an echocardiogram. The echocardiogram center was nearby. The patient went to the echocardiogram center. When he was sitting outside the echocardiogram room, he collapsed and died. Luckily, our doctor, he advised for the investigation in time. You just imagine if he has given some medicine. You know better about the controversies about our medicine. Even though it is doing wonderful job, now criticisms also there. You just forget about that. So the patient's relative came and told that the reason is you are sent for the investigation, correct investigation. So investigative modalities are very much important. Another, I mean, CT, I want to show you. Here you can see another CT image of the brain. It is of my close relative's CT. Has come to my house, says I'm 10 or 15 minutes back, sitting by my side. Immediately, he developed hepatitis. We all know because we were in a function, nearly 15 doctors were there. We all know he is going for a stroke. But the problem here is we have to rule out what type of stroke it is. Is it a hemorrhagic stroke or a hypoxic stroke? So, without going for that, we cannot proceed for the treatment. So we have rushed the individual to the nearby hospital. There he has taken the CT scan. CT scan shows a clear hypodense area of hemorrhage. He is a hypertensive patient, not taking his medicine properly. He developed this type of problem. So in our clinical setup, we want our knowledge to be updated every day to tackle these type of problems and to help the patient perfectly. You can see another slide. This that's CT, how it is going to be in hemorrhage. So hemorrhage is most easily detected with CT, but it can also be visualized with gradient echo MR sequences. So there are many sequences in MR, so it is MR sequencer. Again, here is the image. You can see CT of abdomen. See here, you can see a radio opaque shadow. As the CT, we have to tell only the opaque shadow. You can see a radio opaque shadow. In this radio opaque shadow, you can see a calculus. It is clearly seen here. So the doctors, particularly the homeopathy doctors, should be well versed with all the investigative modality. Then only the treatment for the patient will be perfect. As I already told, that will be helpful in many ways. Again, here you can see the cross section image of the CT. Here the stone is. So usually I'll stop the light. I cannot see, the mind does not know.
So we should be adequately equipped our mind with the knowledge. If we know, if the mind knows, automatically our eyes will search for the evidences. If the evidences are clear, automatically we are going to make our diagnosis. Thereby we are going to render a perfect treatment protocol for the patient. So here is one chest X-ray. So what is evident here? This chest X-ray. Here there is a foreign body. Immediately when we are looking to the X-ray, we'll focus only for a particular area which is eye-catching. In this X-ray, here the eye-catching point is this foreign body. Actually, that is not the real thing. Patient is having fracture. So we should concentrate more only on other areas apart from the eye-catching area, because this is a normal variant. The patient is wearing a piercing. It is nipple piercing. It is a normal artifact. So we have to know what is artifact and what is the real pathology. Next, if you see this X-ray, it's of foot X-ray, fifth metatarsal bones X-ray. You can see there are two X-rays are there. Here is one X-ray and another X-ray is here. It is of different pain. See, rule out which is real fracture and which is not a fracture. See, here you can see. So here, this is the fracture and this one is unfused epiphysis. So fracture and this is unfused apophysis. So like that, we have to rule out the normal with abnormal. So fifth metatarsal base fracture, the fracture line passes transversely across the bone. If it is a fracture, the fracture line will be on transverse. If it is a unfused metatarsal apophysis, it will be more longitudinally. So here is an X-ray. Can you make out anything with this X-ray? It's the same problem. So you can see here, there is a airline crack. You can see airline crack. It is evident of fracture, fifth metatarsal bone. So when a young patient coming with this type of X-ray, we should be differentiate, we should be able to differentiate between the fracture as well as the apophysis. Here, that's another X-ray. Is there any fracture? Can you make out any fracture? If you see the fifth proximal phalanges, you can see a fracture here. Oblique view. Whenever we are asked for the X-ray, we have to ask foot X-ray, AP, as well as oblique view. So here is the oblique view and this is the AP view. So you can see the fracture. So here is one cervical spine AP view or neck AP view. In this neck AP view, you can see the normal narrowing. This is normal. But if you see this, almost like a stipple appearance, this is called as stipple sign. So particularly in the young children, if they are having croup, they will be having this type of sign. This is called as stipple sign. It is a life-threatening sign. We should be able to distinguish this. So you can see the difference. Normal narrowing and steeple-like appearance. So it's croup. So croup also called as acute laryngotracheobronchitis. So you can see all the things. Again, here is one lateral view of neck. In this neck X-ray, you can see normal tracheal shadow along with epiglottis, everything. You can see the normal air column. In this X-ray, if you see, there is a compression over the trachea. This is called as thumb impression sign. So if you see, it is like a thumb impressed over the trachea. So it is because of epiglottitis. So you can see, it is normal. And again, this is epiglottitis. So these type of problems are really life threatening. See, we should be aware of the complications as well as how to handle this type of cases. So this is epiglottitis, you can see that. So it is a life threatening condition caused by inflammation of the epiglottis and aryepiglottic folds. So I don't want to waste much on this information, and let us come to the main part, radiation. See, the radiation is energy that comes from a source as electromagnetic waves. So radiation is nothing but an electromagnetic wave. It is a moving subatomic particle, especially high energy particle. So X-rays are an electromagnetic wave of high energy and very short wavelength. The main reason for penetration is this very short wavelength, which is able to pass through many materials. So you know better about the invention, everything. You just have a look into that. So how the X-rays are produced? We would have studied in our plus two itself. See, highly accelerated electrons, if it is suddenly stopped by a matter, the electrons are bombarded over the tungsten, and it is splitting into this type of rays, alpha, gamma, and X-rays. So the properties of X-rays. So X-rays are having many properties. We are using this penetration for our diagnostic purposes. See, if you take many diagnostic equipments are based on this property only. For example, CT, that is computer tomography, and mammogram, OPG, like that, and DXA also. So how the X-rays are passing through and creating an image. The X-ray that passes through the body to the film render the film dark. So wherever the X-ray is affecting the X-ray plate, that will become black. The X-ray which is passing through will be black, where it is not passing through will be shown as a white shadow. Bone, it is a radio effect material. The X-ray cannot penetrate into that. So X-rays will be shown as a white opacity. If there is any fracture in that particular bone, automatically the X-rays will enter into that, and it will make a shadow in the film. So this is the basic principle. So you can see what are the five X-ray densities. So here black and fat will be shown like a gray, and here the soft tissue, bone and metal will be totally blocked by the X-ray, that will show as a total radio effect shadow. So again, you can see shoulder X-ray here. Here, you can see the density differences. So you can see, it is black. Then fat, here you see, that is tissue. It is almost gray. And soft tissue, you can see here. Then bones. So already, we know the metal will be shown as a white area. Now you can see a OPG image here. Yeah, Mr. Manish, just wait for a few minutes. 1 second.
Yes, sir.
चलेंगे। Yeah, here is OPG image. You can see a clear image here, and you can note a fracture also in the mandible, and you can see a lytic lesion also. Now, the reason why I am showing this is the X-ray should be really clear to have a look. Another thing is we should have minimum a viewing box. That is lobby in our clinic. Without that, we won't get much information. And you know better about the conventional radiography. And you can see the portable X-ray units. And the existing procedure was this type of wet film processing. The X-rays will be taken and it will be sent to the dark room. There they will watch the film and look into that. So now it is replaced with CR, computer radiography. Here, the cancers will be there. X-rays will be formed latently, and we will send that cassette into the CR machine. The image will be acquired, and we will see it over the monitor. And this is the CR image acquisition. So first, the X-rays pass behind, and there will be a phosphor plate. It will come to the image reader. And image will be scaling, and the image will record it. It will become to the computer. That is computer radiography. So these are all again CR, DR. Now CR is replaced with DR, digital radiography. There is no need for a reader. We have to keep the and we have to expose it. This is CR. Siam. The Siam is used in the theater. Yes. Can you hear me?
Sir, little voice is breaking.
Yeah. Breaking. Okay. Is it okay now, Manish? Is it okay now?
It's not perfect, sir.
Not perfect.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Not clear, sir. You can continue.
Yeah, okay. So here you can see CT scan, as I already told. CT scan is also based only on the X-ray. And you can see the mammographic machine. So here is the OPD machine. And here is the DEXA machine. It is also a DEXA instrument. And you can see the ultrasound and MRI scanner, PET scan. These are all having different modalities. And you can see the PET scan. Yes. Radiation, even though it is very much useful, it is having hazardous effects also. So particularly, we should not make the patient to undergo for pregnant ladies for abdominal X-ray or some other things. So if you are pregnant or think you may be, please inform the X-ray technologist before having an X-ray taken. So this is the warning board placed in the X-ray department. So here we can see how much of the radiation we'll get or how much there's a risk will be there. If it is chest X-ray, see it is a millisilverate, see how much radiation we'll be getting it and what is the risk. So if it is CT, so we'll be getting more dose, and the risk of hazards is 1:2200. So unwanted radiation exposure to the radiation should be minimized. So these are the radiation protection devices, and there is a philosophy, that is ALARA philosophy, as low as reasonably achievable. So X-ray should be limited. So preparing for radiation in homeopathy, we are having our own medicines. That is, homeopathy can minimize the impact of risk of X-rays, CT. So homeopathic X-ray, cadmium sulfuricum. These are all the medicines we can prescribe before advising the patient to go for X-ray as well as cadmium sulfuricum.
should close it. Yeah. Is it okay? Again, you can see lateral view of neck. You can see all air columns clearly.
No, seen. Sir.
Yeah. Is it okay?
The PPT is not yet open, sir.
It's not yet open.
No, sir.
Yeah. Is it okay, Manish?
Yes, sir. Now okay, sir.
All right, sorry. Some technical issues are there. Please, bear with me.
It's okay, sir. It's okay, sir. Continue. Yeah.
So, you know, so here is the pharyngeal tonsils. Mainly, I am going to talk about adenoid hypertrophy. See that what is ring here. So you can see the adenoid hypertrophy. So normal pharynx. The adenoid hypertrophy is clearly seen over the X-ray. The hypertrophied adenoid will compress the nasopharyngeal air column. Nasopharyngeal air column compression or indention over the nasopharyngeal air column, which is evident in the X-ray, is mainly because of hypertrophy of the adenoid. So here you can see a minimal indentation. So here is the nose. This is nasopharyngeal air column, and mouth is here. Here we can see the oropharyngeal air column. So here nasopharyngeal air column is mildly obscured with the hypertrophied adenoid. Here you can see it is clearly obscuring. You can see only minimal air is entering into the trachea. The main reason is hypertrophied adenoid. Again, minimal indentation. So here totally the nasopharyngeal air column is compressed by the hypertrophied adenoid. You can see there is no air column at all. The patient or the child will breathe only through the mouth. See, if a patient is coming with this type of problem, immediately you can ask one question: how the child is sleeping, whether with open mouth or with closed mouth. If it is with open mouth, automatically we can come to a clinical conclusion that the patient may be having hypertrophied adenoid. See, the characteristic facial appearance also there, so we can make our diagnosis, spot diagnosis, with this adenoid facies. So underdeveloped thin nostrils, short upper lip, prominent upper teeth, and the child will be having crowded teeth, narrow upper alveolus, high arch palate, hyperplastic maxilla, and eustachian blockage causing the glue ear deafness. The deafness and attentiveness interferes with the learning. Learning disability will be there. Child grow with low intelligence and understanding. So even if it's a small problem, you just see the consequences of that particular problem. So you can see the face of the adenoid face, classical adenoid faces, and you can see the lateral profile. So you can see almost all the features are evident with this child. Crowded teeth and nasolabial fold. You can see all the features are evident here. So idiopathic parents, pinched nose and shallow nasolabial furrows and crowded teeth. The patient will be, as I already told, with open mouth and hyperplasia of gum,
and crowded teeth. Dribbling saliva automatically that parents will tell. So I think you are now clear about adenoid hypertrophy. So to take, to see adenoid hypertrophy, we have to write the prescription Kull lateral view for adenoids. Suppose many doctors will ask for soft tissue neck like that. So we won't get it, because as we are going to see the nasopharyngeal air column, we have to see the main nose. So nose should be included. That be included only in the lateral view of the skull. So we have to ask for the requisition skull lateral view for adenoids. Automatically the technologists know about that and they'll take the proper view. Now we are going to move to the next topic, paranasal sinuses. You know, so here we are seeing frontal sinuses and ethmoidal sinuses here, and you can see the maxillary air sinuses. Usually in the x-rays, we cannot see the sphenoid sinuses, because sphenoid sinuses, it is not shown in this, it will not be shown in this x-ray. So only in the Waters view, we can see with the open mouth, the sphenoid air sinuses will be shown. Another thing is, usually the sphenoid air sinuses will not get infected. So you can see the normal areas of sinuses, frontal, and you can see the ethmoid sinuses, and here is the maxillary sinuses. So in this x-ray, we have to ask for the Waters view for sinuses. So they'll take the x-ray like this. You can see the frontal sinuses and ethmoidal sinuses here. You can see the maxillary sinuses. This is the area of sinuses. So again, so frontal sinuses, here you can see the maxillary sinuses. See, usually we have to ask the Waters view. Previously, the Waters view will be taken only the erect posture. We are taking the sinuses x-ray in erect posture. We can able to see water, that is air fluid level. If you see this x-ray, on the left side, you can see air column. But here, if you see on the right side, this air with fluid level beneath that. So this air fluid level is because of the x-ray taken in erect posture. So whenever we are asking the asking for x-ray, we have to ask for the Waters view. But in the routine radiology department, it is not taken. The main reason is, nowadays, nobody is ready to go for the indicative procedures. Straight they are going for the higher indicativity. If it is possible to get the diagnosis with a minimal invasive procedure or minimal radiation, it is better to prefer that investigative procedure. So here you can see a clear demarcation of the air fluid level. So Waters view of the sinuses showing partial opacification of the right maxillary sinuses with an air fluid level. So you can see it, air fluid level. Again, here you can see paranasal sinuses. Here you can see a haziness. If you want to make out the sinusitis with the x-ray, you have to see for the haziness. Haziness, if it is present over the frontal area or the maxillary area or the ethmoidal area, it is the radiographical future of sinusitis. Here you can see an opacity, a haziness. So if it is haziness, it is because of sinusitis. If it is opacified, opacification indicates it is because of, we can see in the, so here you can see, here maxillary antrum, again it is frontal and right maxillary. So here the patient is having bilateral, frontal, as well as right maxillary sinusitis. You can see that. So haziness denotes sinusitis. If it is opacification, it may be because of, so bilateral maxillary sinusitis. So frontal is normal. You can see the normal black shadows. air shadows. Here you can see it is filled with haziness, mainly because of sinusitis. And I was talking about the opacification. In those X-rays, it is haziness, but here you can see a opacification. It is mainly because of this mucous polyp. So this right maxillary antrum is having mucosal polyp. So it is evident here. If it is haziness, it is because of sinusitis. If it is opacification, it is because of polyp. So we have to differentiate whether it is haziness or an opacification. Again, so can you make out anything with this? Is it haziness or opacification? On the left side, you can see a opacification. It is mainly because of polyp. This is, you can see, it is water's view. This water view, you can see this air fluid level. See, on the left side, the patient is having air fluid level, so which is indicating of left maxillary sinusitis. So referring pain is very important, particularly when we are treating and we are eliciting the patient with clinical investigation. You can see where the pains will radiate. Suppose if it is frontal sinuses, the radiation will be here. If it is maxillary, it will be here. So you can see the radiating areas. If it is sphenoid, usually, as I already told, sphenoid sinuses will not get infected very frequently. If there is any fluid in the sphenoidal sinuses, it may be secondary to an head injury or facial injury. Either the sinuses will be filled with CSF or blood. So if there is any opacification or air fluid level, that may be because of two things. Either it may be filled with CSF or blood. Next, we are going to see. Here is the mastoid air cells. You can see the external auditory meatus. This is normal mastoid air cells. So again, external auditory meatus and mastoid air cells. You can see the mastoid air cells. So here, the complete mastoid air cells are absent. We can see only the right side external auditory meatus. So it is mainly because of bilateral mastoiditis. CSOM. So again, if you see the X-ray, here is the external auditory meatus. There is no air cell behind the external auditory meatus. The landmark of mastoid air cells is 1 inch behind and 1 inch above the external auditory meatus. So you can see on the left side, totally absent. On the right side also, there is no air cells. So it is evident that the patient is having bilateral CSOM. Again, left, right. So there is no air cells at all. So now you can make out adenoid hypertrophy, and you can make out the sinusitis, and you can make out in the sinusitis. You can see the polyps also. Next, you can say make CSOM with the X-rays. So when you are asking for the X-ray, you have to ask for X-ray skull lateral view for mastoids. That is the regular prescription what you have to give. So here CT images, it is bone window. You can see here the normal mastoid air cells are present. On the left side, there is no air cells. Air cells are absent here. Here also it is present. So here it is absent. Here you can see it, end-on view. So sharply demarcated soft tissue densities involving left middle ear cavity and mastoid antrum. Suggestive of left otomastoiditis. That is for the further evaluation. Yeah, this is the report. Now you can see a skull. So this skull, this is called as pepper pot sign or raindrops sign. See, you can see the skull bone is totally filled with pepper-like appearance. or this we can call it as raindrop appearance. It is because of, see again, you can see paper spot skull. It is mainly because of atypical radiographic appearance of punctured lesion. It is glioma. So this raindrop appearance will be seen in multiple myeloma. Again, so the multiple myeloma present in other parts also between the vertebra. So yes, here also you can see the light lesions. Here also you can see the light lesions, and here you can see the skull with hair on it appearance. So in thalassemia major, we can see these type of appearances. So thalassemia major, radicular skull, AP and lateral viewing, widened diploid space, and hair on end appearance. Now, can you able to see that?
Yes, sir. It's clear, sir.
Yes, yes, yes. Please. So, now I am going to show you some practice of skull. So, this is skull AP view. So, when you are if you are suspecting any fracture, you have to ask for skull AP and lateral view. So, AP, lateral view. So, you can see demarcation. So. We already seen. So skull AP view. In the skull AP view, you can see a fracture over here. On the left side, it's normal. On the right side, you can see a fracture here as well as here. These are all normal suture lines. Here is the fracture, and here is the fracture. So you can see the fracture here and here. Again. Here you can see the fracture. This lateral view of skull. It is mainly because of depressed fracture. So you can see the fracture here as well as here. And sphenoid air sinuses is clear. Now we are telling sphenoid air sinuses is clear. As I already told, if there is any opacification, it may be because of CSF or blood opacification. Again. In this X-ray, this lateral view of X-ray, here you can see air fluid level. This air fluid level is because of, as I already told, so here you can see the sphenoid sinuses. Sphenoid sinuses is filled with fluid. It may be CSF or, as I already told, blood. So maxillary antrum is also filled with fluid, and ethmoid sinus also filled with air. It is mainly because of facial injury. So sphenoid air fluid level, no fracture is visible. The air fluid is even in the sphenoid sinuses is due to hemorrhage or CSF leakage, as I have told. The other parasinuses also contain blood due to facial bone injury. This particular patient is having facial bone injury. That is the reason why the patient is having air fluid level. So now you can see the C1 and C2. Here is C1, here is C2. We can see rodent diet process. This will be so you can see. This is lateral view of cervical spine. Here you can see the slippage of the cervical vertebra. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it is forward slipping of 5th cervical vertebra over 6th cervical vertebra. So you can see that. So I told about C1 and C2. Now you can see a fracture over here. Here you can see the dents or watertight process. So watertight process is fractured here. You can see that. So now again in the AP view, you can see the fracture over here. It is called as hangman's fracture. Again, you can see the fracture over here. So now you can see another fracture in mandible, left side mandible, you can see. Again, you can see a fracture over here, and here also there is a fracture. So here you can see a rib fracture. And here also you can see a rib fracture. Along with that, you can see a very big clavicle fracture. So on displaced, clavicle is fractured and displaced. Here you can see shoulder view, AP view, this shoulder view, AP view, again you can see fracture. So here hemothorax is seen mainly due to the rib fracture over here. Here also there is a fracture, and here also there is a fracture. And you can see hemothorax. Again, you can see the hemothorax mainly because of the fracture. And you can note on the pneumothorax also. You can see pneumothorax here. And sternum. So we have to take sternum lateral view or lateral oblique view to see the sternum. So you can see lateral view of sternum. Here is the lateral view. So you can see a fracture over here, sternal fracture. Yes. Now we are going to the topic. See, I don't want to, separately tell about spondylosis, spondylitis, and spondylosis, spondylolisthesis. There are four conditions. One is spondylosis. Here we can see the spondylosis. Another one is spondylolysis and spondylolisthesis. And spondylitis. So together we can see in our regular practice we are going to only spondylosis and spondylitis. It is inflammation of the vertebra, and spondylolisthesis it is forward or reverse slipping of one vertebra over other vertebra. So and spondylolysis. And spondylolysis. Hello, there is some disturbance. Yeah, spondylolysis. So there are four conditions. We are going to see all the four conditions now.
So, hello, sir.
Yeah.
So yes, we are not able to see the slides.
Pardon?
So we are not able to see the slides, sir.
Any slide you cannot see?
No, sir.
Yeah. One second. Is it okay now, Mr. Manish?
No, sir, not yet.
Not yet. Now is it okay?
Only screen we can see, sir, but
yeah, yeah. Can you see the image now?
PPT is not yet open, sir.
Is not it open?
No, sir. Sir, you can just start PPT. After that, you can start sharing, sir.
Yeah. You can see, just tell me.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Now it's clear, sir.
Yes, yeah, okay, right.
Okay,
sir. Yeah. Yes. So I already told about spondylolysis and spondylolisthesis, spondylitis. So you can see the difference. So spondylolysis. So what is spondylolysis? Usually, we won't see it in our regular practice. So it is defect in the pars interarticularis. So we used to tell a scooty dog sign. In the lateral view of the oblique view of the lumbar spine, we are going to elicit this sign. It is called as scooty dog sign. So spondylolysis, fracture of the pars interarticularis. So this is intact here, and here it is fractured. So this is called as scooty dog sign. And as I already told, spondylolisthesis. Spondylolisthesis is forward or backward slippage of one vertebra over other vertebra. It may be in any vertebral area, maybe in the lumbar region or in the sacrum or over the cervical region. So spondylolisthesis, either it is forward or backward slippage of the vertebra. So it is a big event. It is not this slipping, it is the slipping of the vertebral body. The entire vertebral body will get slipped. So you can see the vertebral body has slipped forward. So here you can see L5 is slipped over S1. You can see it here. So spondylolisthesis means vertebral slippage. So it may be congenital or ischemic or it may be degenerative. So here you can see the vertebra is moving forward. We can grading it. There are 5 grades. You can see the grading. So less than 25%, it is type 1. If it is 25 to 50%, type 2. And in type 3, 50 to 75%. And type 4, it is 75 to 100%. In type 5, totally the vertebra will come forward. So it is calling as spondylolisthesis. So anterolisthesis, posteriorolisthesis. The term anterolisthesis refers to anterior displacement forward slip of vertebral body related to one below, that is anterolisthesis. So here you can see. So it is less than, that is between 25 to 50%. So it is between grade 2. Again, you can see. So it is, you can see L4 over L5. That is, it is anterolisthesis. So you can see this is grade 1. So less than 25. Here you can see. Now it is more than 50%. So it is grade 2. So retrolisthesis. So retrolisthesis, as I already told, so there will be slippage into the back. So you can see this particular vertebra is slipped back. And spondylitis. So spondylitis, it is inflammatory process of the vertebrae. That is vertebral inflammation. So here we can see osteophytes as well as disc degeneration. There is a difference between spondylitis and spondylosis. In our regular practice, we are going to see spondylosis only. To rule out spondylosis, we have to see five radiological findings. One is anterior and posterior osteophytes. Second one is intervertebral disc space reduction. Third one is there will be a normal lordotic curve that will be lost here. And in some cases, along with the osteophytes, disc space reduction, we can see other factors. I'll show you. So this is spondylitis, inflammation I told. So this degeneration. So it is inflammation. Inflammation is because of tuberculosis. You can see Bart's disease. Here you can see Bart's disease, tuberculosis here also. So the L1 vertebra is distracted. And ankylosing spondylitis. So ankylosing spondylitis is an autoimmune disease involving the spine and sacroiliac joints and is therefore also form spondyloarthritis. So here also you can see, so in ankylosing spondylitis, usually we'll see a bamboo spine appearance. That's bamboo spine appearance of the cervical region is evident here. Here again, ankylosing spondylitis, bamboo spine appearance. And in ankylosing spondylitis, there will be a sign called dagger sign. So you can see this is the dagger and you can see a dagger sign. It is mainly because of the fusion of the spinous process. So you can see that. You can see the dagger sign. So you can see all the spinous process is fused and giving an appearance of dagger. Again. So now we are going to the spondylosis. As I already told, spondylosis, it is a regular problem we are encountering with older people. It is mainly because of degenerative changes. Here we can see, so you can see the normal cervical vertebra X-ray. And you can see AP as well as lateral view. So in spondylosis, it is vertebral arthritis. So the space between the vertebra, that is intervertebral disc space, will be reduced. You can see the intervertebral disc space are reduced. And you can see the anterior osteophytes. You can see the anterior osteophytes. So here, normal lordotic cervical curve is lost. This is the early indication of cervical spondylosis. So we can grading the cervical spondylosis. Grade 1 is normal. Grade 2, minimal osteophytes, minimal anterior osteophytes formation, and no reduction in the intervertebral disc height, and no vertebral end plate sclerosis. So there will be another radiological finding, end plate sclerosis. So the end plate of the So here is the end plate. This end plate will get sclerosed. So these are all the radiological findings. One is end plate sclerosis, anterior osteophytes or posterior osteophytes, and intervertebral disc space narrowing. These are all the radiological findings to rule out spondylosis. So here you can see all the end plates are sclerosed along with reduction in the joint space. So grade 2, definite anterior osteophyte, subtule or no reduction in the interoperative disc and just recognizable sclerosis of the end plates. So it is grade 2 and grade 3. And in the fourth grade, there will be large and multiple large osteophytes. The severe narrowing will be there and the sclerosis of the end plates with irregularities. So this is grade 4. So again, you can see sclerosed end plates and anterior osteophytes and intervertebral disc space reduction. You can see that. This is almost normal, but here you can see the vertebral body size also reduced. Here it is also reduced. You can see that. Again, you can see intervertebral disc space reduction, anterior osteophyte. You can see the size of the 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth vertebra, fifth cervical vertebra is reduced. So again, you can see anterior osteophytes. Here you can see the disc space reduction. Again, this is normal and this is also normal. So to rule out spondylosis, we have to see 5 things. First one is normal lordotic curve lost. Second one is anterior or posterior osteophyte. Third one is vertebral end plate sclerosis. Fourth one is disc space reduction. If we are eliciting all these 4, we can come to a conclusion that the patient is having spondylosis. This applies to any vertebral region, cervical, dorsal or lumbar. So we have to see all these 4 parameters. If it is evident, we can, as I already told, grading it according to the radiological finding. The same thing applies to osteoarthritis also. We are going to see the osteoarthritis after some time, we'll see that. Again, you can see this. So you can see disc space reduction. So here you can see the compression over the nerve root. Here you can see the nerve root compression. Now we are going to see another pathology, rickets. So how to rule out rickets with X-ray? So rickets, as you already know, it is osteomalacia in pediatric population, apparently seen in second year of life with skeletal changes and bone pain seen in premature infants. Unbalanced infant nutritional nutrition, maternal vitamin D deficiency, and also lack of sun exposure may cause rickets. That may result from abnormality or deficiency in 1,10-5-dihydroxy vitamin D, calcium, phosphorus, alkaline phosphatase, as well as body pH. So here you can see wrist joint AP view. Usually this rickets will be evident in wrist joint, knee joint, and even we can see it in the chest like ricket rosary. So knees, wrists and ankles are affected predominantly. Epiphyseal plates widen and irregular metaphysis cupping, praying will be seen. So here you can see the cupping of the metaphyseal end, you can see that. And the normal carpal bones are not matured. So you can see the serrated appearance here. So serrated appearance, cupping and absent of the normal carpal bone for the age is evident of rickets. Here you can see the bowing of both legs. The bowing of both legs is because of rickets. again knee joint. So you can see the serrated appearance and widening of the epiphysis, and almost you can see mild cupping here. So these are all the radiological finding of rickets. You can see again cupping of the epiphyseal end. You can see here. So here you can see costochondral junction widening. You can see this is the costochondral junction. All the costochondral junction, you can see it is widening because of rickets. So this is giving a ricket rosary appearance. You can see this. So you can see. So same features, cupping, spraying, as well as serrated appearance. So here also you can see. So you can see the rickets rosy appearance of the baby. So these are all the features of rickets: protruding forehead, large head, curved humerus, kyphosis. So you can see everything. Enlarged epiphysis of the ankle. So again, you can see. Actually, this bedding needs only surgical correction. So you can see. So here you can see clavicle fracture. So here you can see dislocation. So this is called as anterior dislocation. So from the glenoid cavity, the head of the humerus has come out. So again, it is anterior dislocation. So this is axial view. Here you can see dislocation as well as fracture. The glenoid cavity itself got fractured. And here you can see a bulb-like appearance of the humerus. It is because of posterior dislocation. So this is called light bulb sign. See, here you can see scapula got fractured. Here you can see subtrochondric fracture. Here you can see the tuberosity. Below the tuberosity, there is a fracture. Again, you can see the fracture here. You see the shaft fracture. So now, here you can see the dislocation of the elbow joint in AP view. So here there is a small fracture, fragment fracture. Here you can see a fracture. It's supracondylar fracture. Above the condyle, there is a fracture. This is otherwise called as pulled elbow fracture. Again, you can see fracture over here. See this raised fat pad sign, either it may be anterior or posterior, maybe because of subtule fracture. So sometimes if there is a fracture over the radial head, there will be a raised fat pad sign. So here you can see a fracture. You see a fracture, small fracture over here, so that is giving fat, raised fat pad sign. In fact, see a fracture over here. So this is actually, there are some types of fracture. This is Modigliani type of fracture. You can see the dislocation. Here, there is another type of fracture, Galesia. Here, you can see a buccal fracture. Here, you can see a fracture. It's a green stick fracture. Here also there is a fracture, buccal fracture. Here also you can see the buckling. So here you can see the epiphysis is totally displaced. This is Salter-Harris fracture. Here you can see a fracture. So now we are going to see three conditions: osteoarthritis. So now osteoarthritis. So again, osteoarthritis, it is degenerative changes associated with the aging process and can affect any joint. The cartilage of the affected joint is gradually worn down, eventually causing bone to rub against bone. So bone is first developed on unprotected bones, causing pain and inflammation. As I already told in spondylosis, the same thing. Here also, we can, because it is also degenerative changes, here also it is degenerative changes, we can expect same type of radiological findings here. So radiographic classification, only spur, that is stage one, stage two, narrowing of joint, and less that is space reduction, stage three, narrowing of joint, and more than half of the joint space reduction. Stage four is obliteration of joint space. Stage five is subluxation of secondary lateral arthrosis. So, special investigation, blood test usually will be normal. Radiological features, there will be cartilage loss, subchondral sclerosis, cyst and osteopyse. So, the extra point here is only the cyst formation. So, this is normal knee joint. Here we can see advanced osteoarthritis, that is grade 3 osteoarthritis, OA. Here you can see the normal joint space. Here the joint space is reduced. You can see the osteopytes. Here also you can see reduced joint space. And as we are seeing it in the vertebra, end plate sclerosis, here we can see the sclerosis. And sometimes here we can see the intercondylar eminence prominence. So intercondylar eminence prominence and joint space reduction, sclerosis, osteopytes, these are all the radiological evidences. Along with that, we can see the cyst also. Here you can see it in the hand. Here you can see the joint space reduction. So here you can see the prominent intercondylar eminences. So you can see the osteopytes and you can see the sclerosed bone. Here you can see PF hand reveals narrowing osteopytes and subchondral cyst. Here you can see the subchondral cyst. In this X-ray, subchondral cysts are evident. Here also there is a cyst. Here is a cyst. So here, these are all the areas of cyst. Again, you can see the cyst here. So it is clear in the CT image. So now OA is over. Now we are going to see osteoarthritis. So arthritis, you know, it is a chronic autoimmune multisystemic inflammatory disease which affects many organs but predominantly attacks the synovial tissues and joints. So clinical presentation, onset may be insidious or abrupt. Early features commonly include tiredness, malaise and generalized aches. Arthritic symptoms typically first develop in the hands and wrists in a symmetric proximal distribution. So the main difference between rheumatoid arthritis and osteoarthritis is here we can see symmetric bilateral joint affection there in here rheumatoid arthritis, but there it will be present only in one joint or sometimes it may be bilateral. So there are markers, there are several serological markers, right? Like rheumatoid factor, the valuable markers are anti-CCP, ACPA. This is more than 80% sensitive and more than 95% specific for rheumatoid arthritis. And there will be elevated CRP as well as ESR. So if you take the radiological features, so you can see. So loss of intercarpal joint spaces, you can see almost it's fused like. So it is always called as Bottinelli or Hitchhiker's thumb. So this is called as swan neck deformity. Almost the appearance of this shape will be like swan neck. So the difference between osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis. In OA, it is only affect joints, not internal organs. But RA will affect joints as well as tissues and internal systems also. Two most common symptoms, pain and swelling. But here, the common symptoms include pain, stiffness and heat. And there will be joints, tenderness, but there won't be any warmth. But here, there will be warmth. So there is a difference between OA and RA. So rheumatoid arthritis, it is more severe than OA, and as we know, it is caused by immune system autoimmune disease, and it can affect people of any age group, but most commonly affects those between the age of 20 and 60. Symptoms can be felt throughout the entire body, affects more women than men. Here in osteoarthritis, generally less severe than RA, caused by wear and tear, that is degenerative changes, generally affects people over the age of 40. Usually only affect joints, commonly found in both men and women. So this is the difference between OA and RA. So here we can see. So the cartilage to begin breaking down. That is in OA. Cartilage remnants will be there. So joint space will be narrowed. Bone spurs will be present. So that is OA. Here in rheumatoid arthritis, we can see bone erosions and swollen or inflamed synovial membranes. Cartilage wears away and bone will get ankylosed. So that is the difference between RA and OA. So you can see the normal joint and OA joint and RA joint. So here swelling will be there as well as inflammation will be seen. All inflammatory signs will be evident here in RA. Next we are going to move to gouty arthritis. So gouty arthritis, it is a disease characterized by an abnormal metabolism of uric acid. This uric acid metabolic defect resulting in an excess of uric acid in the tissues and blood causing inflammation. Either there may be an overproduction of the uric acid or less excretion of the uric acid that give rise to gouty arthritis. People with gout either produce too much of uric acid or more commonly their bodies have a problem in removing it. So primary gouty arthritis. So inherited X-linked trait caused by several inborn errors and purine metabolism. Uric acid is the most is the end product of purine metabolism. It is excreted in urine, but it will be stored in the blood. So that will cause the gouty arthritis. Production of uric acid exceeds the excretion capability of the kidneys. Sodium urate is developed in the synovium and other tissues, which results in inflammation. Males 30s and females and 30s and 40s will get this purine metabolic defect. So there will be four stages: acute, first attack the four stages of gouty arthritis: acute gout, acute gouty arthritis. So in gouty arthritis, you can see hyperuremia and excruciating pain, increased ESR and WBC will be there. So excruciating pain and inflammation of one or more joints, especially metacarpophalangeal joints of the great toe, that is called as podagra. So you can see. Usually in the X-ray, there will be punched out edges or rat bite appearance will be seen. We are going to see that X-ray. So rat bite appearance or punched out edges is the radiological features of gouty arthritis. So this is podagra. So trophies gout. This is trophies. So you can see the bone erosions. As I already told, there will be punched out erosions. You can see the deposition of urate crystals. Urate crystals also will be there in the X-rays. So here you can see the punched out erosion. See, it is like a rat bite appearance. Extensive but periarticular lucency centered on the distal interphalangeal joint of the great toe, large amount of bony destruction with punched out periarticular erosions. Again, you can see the punched out erosions here. Here you can see that. It is all here also. You can see a rat bite like appearance, punched out lesions. So other tests to be done: synovial fluid, uric acid, serum uric acid, and joints X-ray, and synovial biopsy sometimes, and uric acid in urine should be tested. So we have seen gouty arthritis. Now we are going to see psoriatic arthritis. In psoriatic arthritis, see pencil and cup appearance. That is the radiological hallmark of psoriatic arthritis. Psoriatic arthritis, radiograph of both hands demonstrate cup and pencil deformities. So cup and pencil deformity is an radiographic evidence of psoriatic arthritis. So we have seen gouty arthritis, osteoarthritis, rheumatic arthritis, and psoriatic arthritis. Now I think you can able to differentiate all these four types of arthritis. Now we are going to see plain abdominal radiography. The primary means of abdominal X-ray is indication. It is a preliminary evaluation of bowel gas in emergency settings. Negative study, then we can refer for CT, because if it is negative, there is no need for CT, and we can evaluate radiographic tubes and lines and the evaluation of post procedural intraperitoneal or retroperitoneal free gas, monitoring the amount of bowel gases in post-operative ileus, and monitoring the passage of contrast through the bowel, and colon trans study like barium studies, and monitoring the renal and GB calculi. So it is contraindicated for pregnancy. So you can see the normal abdominal X-ray. You can see the liver shadow, and you can see the hepatic flexure, and you can see the fundal air shadow, and you can see the splenic shadow and splenic flexure air shadow of the large colon. So you can here you can see the kidney shadow and psoas muscles. You can see bladder. So can you make out anything in this X-ray? It is plain X-ray, abdominal X-ray. Here you can see multiple calculus with central lucency. So radiographic shadows with central lucency, it is an indication radiological marking of gallstones, right side liver, 12th rib. So this is the area of gallbladder. So you can see multiple radiographic shadow with central lucency. Again, in the lateral view. So here you can see a radiographic shadow near the L4 transverse process. It is because of renal calculus. So here you can see a very big calculus on the right kidney. This is called as staghorn calculus. The shape of the calculus itself shows like a staghorn. here. On the right side, again you can see the stag hand calculus. Stag hand. So it is like a stag hand. So it is a calculus removed from the kidney. You can see the shape and size of the calculus, how big it is. So these are all the different types of minerals which is making deposit over the stones. So there are radiolucent stones as well as radio-opaque stones. So only with plain X-ray we cannot rule out the calculus. The best modality to rule out the real calculus is ultrasound screening. So that will give good information about the stones. So radio-opaque stones, calcium oxalate, again calcium oxalate dioxide and calcium phosphate, carbonate, brucite. These are all radio-opaque stones will be clearly seen in the X-ray. And poor radio-opaque, struvite, cystine, these stones are poor radio-opaque. And radiolucent stones, uric acid and xanthine, these stones cannot be seen in the X-ray, plain X-ray. So as I already told, ultrasound will be the best modality. So stag hand calculus. So also sometimes called as coral calculi. So it is like a shape of a coral. So it will be totally the shape of renal pelvis. So it's almost like a cast. So you can see that. Calculus. So here you can see that. Air as well as fluid level. This is because of intestinal obstruction. Small bowel obstruction, we can see this type of appearance. So here we can see a intestinal obstruction. So you know what is intestinal obstruction? It is telescopic pushing of one part of the intestine to the other part. So you can see the head of intestinal obstruction here. So plain X-ray abdomen demonstrates classical finding of the head of the intestinal obstruction in the transverse colon. Here again you can see the small bowel obstruction. Again small bowel obstruction. So you can see the small bowel obstruction. See here, we can see the large bowel obstruction. So here the pathology, it is obstructing the entire large bowel. So this is also again a thumbprint sign. So here you can see the calcified pancreas. So pancreatic calcification. Red outline arrow points the large clusters of punctured calcification in the location of the body of the pancreas consistent with chronic pancreatitis. The blue arrow points the left 12th rib. So if it is on the right 12th rib, if there is any calculus, it may be because of gallbladder. If it is on the left side, it may be because of, you can see a long calcified areas. It is because of calcification of pancreas.
Mr. Manish?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Shall I continue?
It's okay, sir. Can continue, sir. So we can continue right. For another 10 minutes. After that, we can have question and answer session, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Right. So actually, chest X-ray is a very big topic. So we'll see only some glimpses of chest X-ray. So chest interpretation. So here is chest X-ray PA view. Can you make out anything with this X-ray? So you can see the both costophrenic angles, cardiophrenic angles, apex, and the entire lung field. And you can see the soft tissue shadow also. So bony structure you can see. And you can see the heart shadow. It is normal. But here if you see, bilaterally there is some opacification. This is bilateral hilar opacification. You can see the bilateral hilar opacification. So bilateral hilar opacification may be seen in many instances. So here are the different diagnoses for hilar enlargement. So if it is unilateral, it may be because of primary lung cancer, tuberculosis, or it may be fungal or metastatic carcinoma or lymphoma. If it is bilateral, it may be because of pulmonary artery, maybe because of pulmonary hypertension, and maybe because of lymphadenopathy, sarcoidosis, lymphoma, metastatic carcinoma, TBR fungal, leukemia, or silicosis. These are all the bilateral hilar enlargement DDs. Here, can you make out anything in this X-ray? Again, it is the X-ray of a female. You can see the soft tissue, and you can see both the costophrenic angles. You can see other structures also. Here, you can see some foreign material. This is because of sternal sutures, sternal wiring. You can see the K wiring of the sternum. Along with this, you can see a radio opaque shadow here. So this is called as SPN, solitary pulmonary nodule. SPN, solitary pulmonary nodule. So solitary pulmonary nodule, you can see this. So the solitary pulmonary nodule will be seen. A nodule. So it is a pulmonary, solitary pulmonary nodule. So a nodule is a discrete, more or less rounded opacity, less than 3 cm in diameter. A solitary pulmonary nodule is well circumscribed, more or less rounded opacity, less than 3 cm in diameter, with the lung parenchyma unassociated with adenopathy, atelectasis, or pneumonia. You know what is adenopathy? Atelectasis. It is partial or full collapse of the lung or pneumonic opacity. Mass is a discrete, more or less rounded opacity. The size of the mass will be more than 3 cm. And there will be a pattern, nodular pattern. Nodular pattern is characterized by a collection of innumerable small discrete round opacities that measures 2 to 10 cm, 10 millimeters in diameter. This radiographic pattern is typical of certain interstitial lung disease. So there will be a mass or a single nodule, solitary pulmonary nodule, or there may be a nodular pattern. Along with that, there is another pattern, interstitial pattern, that we'll see it afterwards. So here again you can see a SPN, solitary pulmonary nodule. So here you can see a mass. So this will be surely more than 3 cm. So it is a mass. So now you can see a small SPN, solitary pulmonary nodule, or a big mass like this. So if it is a small, less than 3 mm diameter,
a well subscribed rounded opacity, it may be a solitary nodule. So if it is more than 3 cm, it will be a mass. So here you can see multiple small opacities. It is discrete. So this is called as nodular pattern. So here there are plenty of nodules, small nodules. This is called as nodular pattern. Or usually in miliary tuberculosis, we'll see this type of nodular pattern. So if it is malignant, you can see primary lung carcinoma, solitary metastasis, carcinoid tumor, or primary lung lymphoma. In the benign condition like infectious granulomas, aortotoma, round pneumonia, AV malformation, rheumatoid nodule, vaginal sclerosis, abscess, and pseudo nodule. So this will give an appearance of a nodule. See here, as we already seen, here you can see bilaterally nodular pattern. You can see the multiple nodules almost spreading over the entire lung. So it is nodular pattern. As I already told, this nodular pattern, the size will be between 2 to 10 mm. So the nodular pattern will be evident in sarcoidosis, miliary tuberculosis, helioosteochondrosis, and pneumoconiosis, like silicosis or colorectal pneumonia. Then in malignant condition like metastatic lung disease and bronchoalveolar carcinoma, we can see this type of nodular pattern. See here, you can see a very big mass. It is not a nodule. It is not a nodular pattern. It is a mass. The size will be more than 3 cm. So the airspace disease pattern or alveolar pattern is characterized by a homogeneous density with an ill-defined border. There is usually no volume loss noted, and the distribution may be diffuse or focal. It presents the air bronchogram sign. So you can see an air bronchogram sign. So you can see an air bronchogram over here. See, here is the air bronchogram. Now you can see the air bronchogram. That air bronchogram sign. So the airspace diseases pattern is the result of the alveoli filling with any of the following. It may be because of cardiogenic or non-cardiogenic edema, or it may be because of pus, or it may be because of blood, or it may be because of cells like tumor cells, and it may be because of lipoprotein. Now you can see another pattern here. This pattern is called as reticular pattern. Now this reticular pattern is an important topic because it is appearing like a ground glass. So this ground glass appearance is an evident CT finding of COVID patients. Now the X-ray chest is not so much indicative for a COVID patient, but CT scan will give a good understanding about the COVID prognosis. It is not for the investigative, it is not for the investigation, it is mainly to rule out the prognosis. So it is reticular pattern. So it is described as an interlacing network or line shadows which suggest mesh or net. So these are all the following conditions: interstitial pulmonary edema, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, granulomatous diseases, interstitial pneumonia. That is, it may be because of viral. So now the viral disease, it will give an appearance of interstitial pneumonia. So now you can see a dense opacity here. It is not because of mass. You can see a meniscus sign. This meniscus sign is a radiological sign of pleural effusion. So I think you know all these things. So there will be a collection between this pleural cavity, that is pleural effusion, usually 2 to 10 ml of pleural fluid will be present in the lungs. If it is more than 200 cc only, we can see the blunting of costophrenic angles. So here you can see the blunting of costophrenic angles. I mean, right costophrenic angle. It is mainly because of pleural effusion. Again, you can see the meniscus sign. You can see the ground glass appearance or haziness, diffuse haziness of the left chest. It is mainly because of the X-ray is taken in lying posture, supine posture. So the fluid may be transudate or exudate. If it is transudate, it may be because of congestive heart failure or cirrhosis or nephrotic syndrome. If it is exudate, it may be because of neoplastic disease, infections, pulmonary embolism, collagen vascular disease, drug induced or pancreatic disease, hemothorax or chylothorax. Here you can see a well circumscribed nodules. It is not nodular pattern, but it is like a ball like appearance. This is called as cannon ball appearance. So different diagnosis for multiple pulmonary nodules. It may be malignant tumors, metastatic disease, lymphoma, branchialveolar carcinoma. It may be because of inflammation like septic emboli, fungal and nocardia, mycobacteria and Peyer's glandomas and rheumatoid nodules, and it may be because of sarcoid, and it may be seen in multiple pulmonary AVMs and silicosis and coal workers pneumonia. You can see the same here, this cannon ball appearance of varying sizes. Usually this type of appearance will be seen in metastatic diseases. Here you can see a very big bulla. So totally loosened area. So in the pulmonary hypertension, you can see the ILR opacification. So here there is a pneumothorax. If you see both the lungs, this is more of radiolucent. So there is a reason. This is black. Here you can compare it. So hyperlucent lung may be because of emphysema, COPD, or may be because of asthma, acute exacerbation, or pulmonary hypertension. If it is focal, it may be because of unilateral airway obstruction, bulbar bleb, pneumothorax, pulmonary embolism, and general lung disease. So COVID, so now as is a hot topic, I think we can know something about COVID imaging findings. COVID-19 is a viral disease, also known as SARS-CoV-2 or severe respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2. The diagnosis is made by positive PCR test, which is highly specific. CT has a higher sensitivity but lower specificity. So because in many conditions, the same findings will be seen. So the diagnosis and treatment of the disease. Now we can see the role of imaging. So chest radiograph, the chest film is insensitive early in the disease. Here a comparison of a chest radiograph and CT image. The ground glass opacities in the right lower lobe on the chest and the CT is evident, but it is not visible in the chest radiograph. You can see that. So here is the chest radiograph. It seems almost normal, but if you see in the CT, here you can see the ground glass appearance. You can see the ground glass appearance. So PCR test is very specific, but as a sensitivity of 65 to 95%, so there will be chances for false negative also, which means that the test can be negative even when the patient is infected. Another problem is that we have to wait for 24 hours while CT results are available right away. Common laboratory findings in COVID-19 are a decreased lymphocyte count and increased CRP and high sensitive CRP. These two things will be elevated along with that decrease in the lymphocyte count. These are the laboratory findings. And chest CT, ground glass opacity. The ground glass patient is most common findings in COVID-19 infections. They are usually multifocal, bilateral, and peripheral. So this is the main important factor here. Usually it will be seen peripherally, bilaterally, and it will be multifocal. But in the early phase of the disease, the ground glass appearance may be present as a unifocal lesion, most commonly located in the inferior lobe and the inferior lobe of the right lung. So CT image of a young male, so we are going to see that, who had fever for 10 days with progressive coughing and shortness of breath, saturation at admission was 66%. The PCR test was positive for COVID-19. There are widespread bilateral ground glass opacities with a posterior predominance. So normal lung will be seen like this. So blood vessels will be clearly seen. So if it is the ground glass appearance will be seen like this. If it is a consolidation, we can see a radio opaque density like this. So these are all the differences. So this is normal lung, ground glass appearance and consolidation. So here you can see the ground glass appearance. It is more on the peripheral, more on the peripheral of the lung. It is bilaterally present. And there is another radiological finding, that is crazy paving. So you can see the crazy paving. So sometimes there are thickened interlobular or interlobar lines in the combination with ground glass pattern. This is called crazy paving. It is believed that this pattern is seen in somewhat later stage, not in the initial stage. So here is the crazy paving pattern. You can see the crazy paving pattern. So you can see the crazy paving pattern. So the imaging is not indicated in patients with suspected COVID. So as it is not a confirmatory test, we should not advise the patient to go for CT scan. As I already told, it is mainly to see the prognosis and mild clinical features unless they are not at risk. So if the patient is only at risk only, we have to go for the CT scan. It is not for the regular investigative procedure. So if the patient is worsening respiratory status, we can go for CT scan. So again, you can see the ground glass appearance with crazy pattern. So another radiographic feature of this COVID infection is vascular dilatation. You can see the vascular dilatation. Here, the vascular blood vessels are dilated. So a typical finding of area of ground glass appearance along with the vascular dilatation. This vascular dilatation is mainly because of the emboli. So here also you can see the vascular widening again. So along with these three findings, traction bronchiectasis is another finding of COVID infection. So it is traction bronchiectasis. You can see the traction bronchiectasis or banding. So subpleural banding. So you can see that. So there will be architectural distortion and subpleural bands. There will be subpleural bands. So these are all the findings of CT chest in COVID positive cases. Manish, time is over.
Yes, sir. I think we can conclude the session, sir.
Yes.
Okay. Can we proceed to question answer session, sir?
No problem, please. Yeah.
If anybody having any question, they can put their questions in the chat box. So one question is
yes. So there is they are asking about spondylitis as well as spondylosis. As I already told, spondylosis is a degenerative condition. Spondylitis is a inflammatory process. So in spondylitis, I mean, there will be destruction. For example, in Pott's disease, there will be destruction of the entire body of the vertebra. If you take it in spondylosis, it will be, as I already told, four findings will be there. One is, if it is in the mild early stage, there will be loss of normal lordosis. In advanced stages, we can see the osteophytes, either it may be present anteriorly or posteriorly, and there will be destruction of the joint space. Joint space reduction will be there. And another finding is end plate sclerosis. These are all the main radiological findings of spondylosis. In spondylitis, as I already told, there will be inflammatory changes. Next question. Yes.
If anybody having questions, kindly put in the chat box. One more question is there.
Yes. So, as I already told, see, now you won't believe, I am almost living with COVID infection. I am in a place in Chennai where we are having many fold of cases every day. I am having a diagnostic center there. We are getting at least minimum 10 to 15 chest x-rays positive with COVID. So, as I already told, in chest x-ray, it will be seen only in the latter stage. So you can see the disease process of COVID. First, if there is an infection, first the patient will be having throat irritation, throat pain. Along with that, there will be fever. And in most of the cases, anosmia as well as loss of taste will be there. Next, the fever will be last for one day. Sometimes it may be there for 2 days. So if the fever is continuing for 5 days, then the patient will be having breathlessness. Another main symptom of COVID is the patient will be having cough. Initially the patient will be having fever, as I have already told, throat irritation, throat pain, and cough. Maybe even after 1 or 2 days. If the cough starts, I mean, after 2 or 3 days, we can conclude indirectly that the COVID infection would have taken 2 or 3 days prior. So, first day there will be throat pain and irritation, and the cough will start after 1 or 2 days also. And there will be a silent fever, there won't be any fever for a few days. Then the patient will develop breathlessness. So usually the breathlessness will start around 6th to 7th day. If you are taking CT around 6th or 7th day, we can see the findings, as I already told, that radiological findings will be seen. So after, say, some 10 or 15 days, there will be no reabsorption of the findings. We all know that it is mainly because of DIC, that clotting is making this type of peripheral ground glass appearance. So initially there will be any signs, only in later stage we see the chest signs like that bilaterally. It will be in the lower segment.
Sir, one more question is there.
Yes.
Why ground glass appearance is seen, means how it occurs?
Yeah, I think you would have seen a slide which I have put. So you can see the normal black lung, and another one is, you can see somewhat gray color. Third one is totally a mnemonic change, mnemonic consolidation. There was three slides. One is black, normal lung. Another one is with the gray color. Third one is white color. That is dense opacity. The main reason is, as I already told, in COVID, the endothelial cells of the blood vessel is destructed. So there will be discharge of emboli, hemorrhages. So that is going and obstructing these blood vessels and giving a appearance of ground glass. So I already told you, it is like a interstitial pattern. So in interstitial pattern, we are going to see the ground glass appearance. That is the reason why the lung is having a ground glass appearance, a radiological finding in CT, as well as in advanced days in X-rays also. Yes, sir.
Sir, I think no more questions are there.
Yes. Yes, I think we can conclude, Mr. Manish.
Yes.
Anyway, thank you very much for all the viewers. Sorry, there was some technical issues because here there are some, networking problem. Somehow we managed it. Thank you for your patient watching. Thank you once again. Again, I am thanking the management of Alvas Omeyaz Medical College and the organizers of this particular event. Thank you very much.
I'd like to hand over Faber Mary Johnson for the vote of thanks. Over to you, Faber.
On behalf of staff and students of Alvas Homeopathic Medical College, I would like to take this opportunity to extend our heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Anand for accepting our invitation and taking time out of his schedule to impart his knowledge and experiences with us. Thank you, sir, for sharing with us the information. And good night, everyone.
Good night. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Manish. Thank you.